You're listening to Critical Mass Radio. Now, it's our turn.
Radio. This is A Peace of Mind. Me, your host, Miquel Llobera.
But I am here to attain omnipresent supergalactic oneness.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. I am Miquel Llobera, also known as Fettle Feign, and indeed I have yet to attain omnipresent super intergalactic oneness. But I'm nearly there, folks. I'm getting there, day by day, as I'm sure you are too. Right, well, I've been told that the music's been coming through loud and clear, so I've got no problems with that. I hope I'm coming through with my voice loud and clear also. Noticed that there's already a discussion on chemtrails in the chat room today. Funnily enough, I was having a conversation with somebody about chemtrails. Generally, I've been up in Morecambe, just on the edge of Morecambe, for the last week or so, and no chemtrails up there. Not surprising, really, because it's sort of a microclimate up there, especially in the Pennines. It's got its own sort of microclimate, it's got its own pressure systems, and so I can't see it being, I can't see there being any point in them spraying up there, because I don't think it would have much of an impact because of that microclimate, which is fortunate really, since we've decided to move up there, and after we've house sat my beautiful wife's mother's house for the 3 weeks she's in Australia, we will be moving into a flat up there. A village called Slime, in the beginning of November. So, all being well. And hopefully, they won't keep up with the chemtrails. It's been a beautiful weekend, actually. Had a nice, lovely drive across the Lancashire and Yorkshire countryside on Saturday, I believe, or yesterday. It was yesterday. Really nice day. Really enjoyed it. How's everybody's week been? Been okay? Right, well, I shall begin the show, as I have previously, by stating a disclaimer that anything, any and all opinions expressed within this show are purely the opinions of myself and are not necessarily shared by any of the other hosts or the station of Critical Mass Radio as a whole. So if you do feel offended in any toe-curling way by what's expressed or said here today, I suggest you sod off, tune out, change the channel, go find some jugglers to entertain yourself. freedom of speech is still alive and well in this country, and I hope to maintain that today. Not that I seek to offend anybody. By all means, I seek to enlighten and to enhance people's experiences in life. I don't seek to offend, I don't seek to upset, rock the cart of any individual or any unique person. I do aim to upset and rock the cart of the state, of course, and all and sundry that involve themselves with the state, put on a uniform and swear false allegiance. So, what have I got for you today? Well, apart from the usual selection of excellent songs, I was interviewed earlier on this afternoon by two wonderful chaps, a guy called Nathan and a chap called Lewis, who are from a group known as Fight Free, Fight Racism, Fight Imperialism. Now, I don't know if you remember one of my earlier shows. I played an interview with the head of one of the groups that meet up for Fight Racism, Fight Imperialism at the Vine Inn. Essentially, they are a communist group slash socialist group. I know it sort of sparked discussion and debate as to, you know, communism's bad, any ism's bad, really. But generally their hearts are in the right place and, you know, they want good things for the good people of this earth. So I felt it was worth hearing what they had to say. And I felt that, you know, they had some good points. But anyway, the reason I was interviewed today is because they are making... they are making a documentary about the recent Venezuelan election, of which Hugo Chavez has won by an absolute landslide. And even the Western groups that have been sent to monitor the elections to make sure they're free and fair have said categorically that they have not found any fault with the elections at all, that it was indeed a free and fair election. There's been no rigging. And it's undeniable that Hugo Chavez has won by a landslide. And it's not surprising Hugo Chavez has won by a landslide because of the social changes he's implemented in Venezuela and assisted to implement in other South American countries are absolutely phenomenal. And if it's not something you've looked into, I know we're pushing here in this country for social change. Now, if you want to see an example of social change implemented in a good, positive and productive manner, look to South America, look to Venezuela, look to Cuba, look to Peru, look to these countries, because they are really, really putting their money where their mouth is, and the people are really getting off their ass. There's no lethargia over there, there's no political lethargia. Oh no, they all get off their asses and they do things, they do something about things, you know. They shift into gear and they move forward and they dance the dance, you know what I mean? They don't just talk the talk, they walk the walk. And so I was interviewed today for a documentary they're going to be making about the elections and comparisons between Venezuela and UK, social movements in Venezuela and social movements here in the UK. So I've met them before, Nathan before, and let him know that I was a host on a social radio network that dealt with issues, so very social issues from corruption to conspiracies and to day-to-day social issues. So he wanted to, and he knew I had a keen interest in South America and the things that go on there, so he wanted me to interview me for a small segment in this documentary, which I was quite pleased about, more than happy to contribute to. So I'm going to be playing for you today that interview in two parts. It was about half an hour, just over half an hour, the good stuff anyway. So I'll be playing it to you in one part of 20 minutes and another part of 10 minutes. I would have split it off into three part segments. However, by the time I managed to get to the computer to put it onto SoundForge, to chop it all down, I had scarce minutes left before the show time to begin. And literally, I literally loaded up the second part of the interview with 16 seconds to go before show time. So, you know, I think I deserve a round of applause. So, right, well, I would like to say also, before I move on with the rest of the show, that if you wish to contact me, Indeed, I encourage you to contact me whilst I'm on air on the show and to discuss anything that's on your mind. Happy to talk about it, whatever it may be. Enlighten me, educate me, because, you know, when Socrates was asked why the oracle at Delphi had told him he was the wisest man on the planet, and when he was asked why the oracle at Delphi had told him this, he simply replied, "The oracle at Delphi told me I'm the wisest man on earth, not because I know everything, but because I know that I know nothing." And so, in that same train of thought and in that same ilk, I too know that I know nothing. So I'm open to being educated and to being enlightened by you listeners and fellow Truth Movement people. So do feel free to call in by clicking the link to Skype that I'm sure is on the Critical Mass website somewhere. If you haven't figured out how to call Skype now, there's no hope for you. So, or you can contact me directly to my Skype account, Fettle Feign, all one word, lowercase letters. Of course, you can't ring me through that because that would cut off the show. You can, however, send me text message through that, and I'll be more than happy to chat and reply on that. Just make sure that when you add me, you put a little comment on saying that you're contacting me through Critical Mass Radio. Alternatively, in the long run, you could email me at peaceofmind@criticalmassradio.co.uk. It's peaceofmind@criticalmassradio.co.uk, and I will get round to answering my emails and replying to you at my earliest convenience. So, suffice to say, I hope you're sitting comfortably, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. And I would like to say that all, and I repeat, all is welcome. Excellent film. If Paul, our friend, my friend and yours, Philip Makes Movies, was here, I'm sure he'd link a clip to the trailer for us. However, I do believe that he's off visiting Rob Freeman, who I think we should mention, as far as I'm aware, still going to have his court case tomorrow, which is at 10 a.m. in the morning, Sheffield Magistrates Court. So if you are able to go, please do go support our very own Rob Freeman. I know he's given me help, and I would like to support and give him help. I'm going to try my hardest to get down there tomorrow. So, yeah. How's things, folks? Do we think we're moving forward? Do we think we are making progress? Things coming together? Synchronicities occurring? There's a few synchronicities occurring in my life at the moment. So, yes, indeed. Good luck, Rob, from Lisa. Hello, Lisa, by the way. Should we see who's in the chat room? Got me, of course. Kat. Hello, Kat. Hello, Lisa. Patron saint of Critical Mass Radio. Paul Giovanni, of course. Snorby. Hello, Snorby. Don't think I've chatted with you before. And, of course, we have Anon, Anon, Anon. 5935. Anon, 5625. Anon, 8869. Designation. So yeah, wherever you hail from, whether be it Britain or another part of the world, whether you're listening today through the website, whether you're listening through Pal Talk, or maybe you're listening through podcast some point in the future, glad you're here, glad you're listening. There are some things going on in and around the world at the moment. A lot of things coming up. As far as I'm aware, November 5th is still going down. A lot of people from all over the world going to congregate sometime in on November the 5th down at Parliament Square. But that'll be an interesting one. I think there's something else going on in November as well. Lots of things going on, lots of things up and coming. Of course, I'm going to be in the process of moving house and settling down up north. Yes, you can. My beautiful wife and beautiful young son, but baby son, is here.
Hello. And, been a while.
Yeah, indeed. Yes, and my son is suckling at the breast of my beautiful wife.
Oh dear.
Getting his fill. He's only just over 4 weeks old, and he's already weighing in at over 12 pounds.
Yeah. 5 weeks tomorrow. Aren't
oh yeah, 5 weeks tomorrow, and he's huge, big baby. One of the things they say about the advancing in consciousness, when you get to a higher level of, when a species achieves a higher level of consciousness, one of the most notable physical changes is a change in size and height. And apparently the next level of consciousness above ours produces people between 7 to 9 foot or 8 to 10 foot.
Future of CMR.
So the future of CMR. Future's bright. The future's critical. Yeah. So unfortunately, I've not really been keeping up with things per se, because various things have been going on, and I've sort of taken the step of avoiding things that are going on in the greater world, all the things that are going down, all the bad things, not because I don't want to be aware of them, not because I'm not concerned about them or I don't care about them, it's just I don't want to lend my energy to them. I don't want to lend my energy to negative things, I want to lend my energy to positive things. So, you know, if you want to call in today, let me know something positive that's happening, you know what I mean? Tell me, I want to hear positive things, I want to hear progressive things, I want to hear things that are happening in the world, you know, that this is what people need to hear. I addressed this last week on the show, that I think a lot of things that happen, a lot of the times what happens is that people know something's wrong, you know, people feel it deep down inside. The average Joe on the street, they might not know exactly what's going on, they might not know names of people, organizations, they might not understand the structure of it all exactly, but they know something is wrong, and they're afraid of it. Some would argue quite rightly, but unfortunately that's the aim of the game as far as the people, the powers that were, are concerned, is the fear, because fear, when you're in fear, you're much more easy to control. So, you know, the people are already unsettled and already afraid. When we go around with a megaphone or whatever, what have you, or just, you know, going in people's faces and saying, look, wake up, this is what's happening, this is what's happening. You know, and we start naming the demons, start naming the shadows, it makes it very more real and very more impactful, and it in a sense it almost justifies and reinforces that fear in them, and all you're doing there is justifying and reinforcing that very aspect of their psyche which makes them more easy to control. So you're not really doing them a favour, you're not really doing the movement a favour.
I just want to talk about a little bit more about vaccines and a little bit about the microchipping of children.
All right. Yes. Well, vaccinations.
They're coming up soon.
Yeah. Well, we're coming up to our the moment where we're going to have to fight the fight against vaccinations for our son.
You said she had polio as a kid, and you said that's pretty much.
Yeah, the health visitor said she had polio when she was a kid, which I was quite shocked about because usually polio is very crippling. But she seems to be all right about.
She was perfect.
She was perfectly fine. So just goes to show, you know. We can treat things when people, you know, whatever happened to figuring out how to cure diseases, whatever happened figuring out how to effectively treat things, you know what I mean? Oh, and on 8869 has also pointed out that it's shroom season. Well, hey, always a bonus indeed. Edible and magies as well. Also on my wife's app, in fact, you better tell them, what was that last comment about the vaccines?
That's it. The one about
how they've been so much more calm.
Oh God, yeah. A couple of women were going, oh, my children have been really calm since they've had the vaccine. Well, they're probably doped up to the eyeballs.
Well, that's it. Yeah, they've calmed down. They're not crying so much. They're
sleeping through the night. It's brilliant.
Sedated. They've been something key and significant in their minds have been switched off. You know, I mean. It's all very well and good when you say, oh, can I have the insert? And you point out chemicals that are in there and you say, well, why is that in there? You know, well, what's that good? And you can make those arguments. But, you know, for me, key, it's the things that they don't tell you that's in there. And, you know, there's nothing stopping them. There's no way for you to know. Nobody's got a lab at home that allows them to be able to look at minute detail. You know, nobody's got an electrospectrometer in which they can measure out at the exact portions of every element of chemical that's in those vaccines themselves. So even... when you're going off the insert, there's no saying whether absolutely everything that's in it is in the insert. I mean, some of the things that are on the insert are worrying enough to begin with anyway. I mean, there was that incident with the French pharmaceutical company, I forget the name of it, that had supposedly had HIV in the vaccines. I mean, now I don't think HIV or AIDS exists personally. I think it's a myth, and there's a lot of evidence to support that it's a myth. But supposing that it does exist, Apparently there was a massive contamination with so many. I think it was well over 40,000 vaccinations that had been contaminated with HIV, maybe even more, maybe even for hundreds of thousands. Le chemist, yeah, indeed. Le pharmacie. But did they take them off the market? Well, they certainly took them off the European market. They certainly took them off the American market. Did they throw them away? Destroy them? No! They sold them to Africa! Still got to make a profit on them, so we'll sell them to brown people. Sell them to black people. Fucking who don't know any better. Can't fucking... You know what I mean? Who are just desperate to find any way to make sure their children survive. So, this is sad, really. Also, in the baby news this week.
Vicky's
rantings. The microchip.
Because of that 5-year-old girl going missing on my app again, there was someone going, would you microchip your child to keep them safe? And a terrifying amount of people said yes. Mm-hmm. Because you microchip your dogs, so why not microchip your children? Someone stated. And I was just horrified, like, because you should just keep an eye on your kids.
Yes.
It's
exactly. Good parenting skills. Microchips are not a substitute for good parenting skills.
And it's like, well, when do you take them out? do you take them out? Or do we just track them?
Especially, they're using the whole, I forget her name now.
April Jones.
April Jones.
It is sad. It is very sad.
It's very sad what happened to her.
People who are listening to think
it's very sad what's happened to her. And also, the whole scenario that's been well blown out of proportion at the moment. I mean, as far as I can see, from what little I've heard of it, off the back of just a neighbour saying she'd seen this guy
in the area
at the time, purely off the back of that, they've arrested this guy. For as far as I know, done him for murder. They haven't even found a body, so we don't even know if it's murder. And they've jumped on this guy. Now, I'm not saying he's guilty, I'm not saying he's not guilty, but as far as I'm aware, in this country, you're innocent until proven guilty.
You won't be able to get a normal life back, even if you
wouldn't even be able to get a normal back life, yeah, even if he was proven innocent, like, he'd be hounded forever. That's his life ruined now, really, if he is innocent. Now, I don't know if he is innocent or if he isn't innocent, but the point of the matter is they're going to use this to lobby for microchipping children. They're going to use this to bring in some form of greater social controls, no doubt. So it's just going to turn into one big, massive fiasco. You can just see it. I don't think anybody... is anybody asking questions of the fact that microchipped animals tend to develop tumours, microtumours, around the site of microchips? No, I don't think... I bet no newspaper's going to mention that fact, are they? No. I mean, let's face it, the whole way a microchip works is it's giving off a constant electromagnetic signal. It's giving a constant pulse off. So that's interfering with the electromagnetics, the bioelectromagnetic field of the body. So, of course, it's going to cause tumours. Of course, it's going to interfere. It's going to do, you know... I mean, as everybody who listens to this show is probably well aware of the dangers of microchips, and the intention of the establishment and the state to introduce microchips at some point, maybe this is their inroad. Maybe this whole incident with this girl is a setup, is a false flag. I mean, I'm not saying it is, but it's got potential. Do you know what I mean? It's got potential for it. There seems to be very scant information and evidence coming out, that this guy is guilty, or that this guy's the one. It seems all very rushed, and you know what I mean. It was within 48 hours, 52 hours. He was arrested within 24 hours, but he was held, taken to a court, and he's been charged without the where's the corpus delicti? We'll produce the body. Habeas corpus, where's the body? Produce the body. There's no body yet. So how can they, off the back, you know, I just don't understand. I mean, obviously, I could be jumping the gun here. Do you know what I mean? I could be jumping the gun, and I could be, this guy could be guilty for all I know. But it just seems very convenient. Very, very convenient. Very quick. You know what I mean? Far too quick for any decent level of investigation to go by. I mean, let's face it, I was arrested in May.
Yeah.
15th of May, I was arrested in suspicion of producing of drugs and siphoning of electricity, right? And I still have not been charged. And they're telling me they still haven't got forensics back from the thing. And yet, this guy who's being held on kidnapping and murder, without even producing of a body, as this guy's been arrested and charged in less than 72 hours.
Well, she went missing on the Monday night, 7 p.m. And it was already in the press within a few hours after that. And usually they say, wait 24 hours before you report a child missing. So fast was that.
Yeah.
There was pictures, they were saying, oh, she was seen getting into a light-coloured van.
Mm-hmm.
The pictures they released of this gentleman's car, it's a dark Land Rover.
Right.
You know, and it's like, people seem to have just forgotten that and be like, yeah, well, it's him.
When
they found him very quickly, and it's like, suppose it's 24 hours before they start putting things out.
So it's very suspicious. Very, very suspicious, all in all. I think that further investigation, I think this is something people need to keep their eyes out open on, because I think this could be the false flag that they were using.
I do hope she's found safe and well, though.
To bring in microchips. Of course, I hope she's found safe and well. But if it is a false flag in order to bring in microchipping, then
she won't be found.
She won't be found. Chances are she won't be found at all, ever. That would be the ideal excuse for the microchipping, because then they'll turn around and say, well, we never found the body, but if she'd been microchipped, at least we would have been able to find the body.
People say, if you're microchipped, it's not going to keep your kid any safer.
No.
We'll find
the body, we'll have something to bury.
The bad men, so to speak, exactly. will still take your child if they want the child.
I'm laughing, it's a morbid subject, it's a topic, I'm laughing, but you know, you've got to laugh while you cry. It's a very serious topic, and you know, but... People think
it'll just make their child
magically safer.
People will still find ways. The police are out there to protect us.
And believe you me, I am far less wary of strangers on the street interacting with my son than representatives of the state, i.e. policemen, nurses, health people, social workers, police.
Right, are we going to stop now?
Anybody with a uniform or a title attached to the state, you know what I mean? That's who I will be teaching my son to not to talk to and to avoid at all costs. Where do the chips go? As far as I'm aware, the chips go in the arm.
Do they?
Yeah.
I thought it was going to be literally like a dog in the back of the neck or something.
No, they go in the arm. Because I know in Spain they have ID chips. They've had IGD chips for years in Barcelona.
The FDA have actually approved them in America.
Oh, in Spain they've had them for years for people to get into nightclubs to prove that, because the bouncers have like scanners and they'll go beep and shows that they're of the right age to get in. Yeah, I know. That's been around for a while. That's been around for years in Barcelona. Exactly, yeah. Just so they don't have to fucking produce.
I do.
Sorry, swearing. They don't have to produce.
Sorry, yeah.
Anyway, and that was Christy Moore with Viva la Quinta Brigada, about the brave men and some women who travelled over from all the nations in Britain to over to Catalonia to fight Franco and to fight the fascists over in Spain. My grandfather fought in that war, didn't die in it. Managed to live through it, but sad times indeed, and they gave their lives for a good cause. Right, so without further ado, this is part one of the interview I made for the Venezuelan documentary, so kick back, relax, smoke some if you've got them, and enjoy my rantings and ravings.
Could you start off, first of all, just explaining who you are and what you do?
Right. Well, my name's Miquel Llobera of the family Llobera. It's a Catalan name. I'm half Catalan myself, half English. I'm a host for Critical Mass Radio, which is an internet radio station at criticalmassradio.co.uk. Which is essentially a collection of hosts who make shows based around social concern, politics, conspiracy, corruption. A lot of corruption is dealt with both politics, the church corruption, state corruption, on as many levels as possible, police corruption as well. We do play music as well. But this is quite a varied set of shows. My show focuses mostly on personal psychology, personal development, spiritual development. The whole principle of my show is based around a peaceful mind is a powerful mind. So to be in control of one's thoughts and one's emotions puts one in a better position to be able to tackle and to fight those things which we're all trying to change for the better, really. You know, we're trying to get rid of those corrupt politicians, we're trying to make the police do their job, catch criminals rather than plague the average person on the street, stop things like child molestation, child kidnapping, and generally to help unite everybody and move forward in a direction that's going to be most beneficial for everyone.
Okay. In that context, why do you think the Bolivarian Revolution in Venezuela is important? Why, you know, why should we care?
Well, it's very important. I remember I first came into the knowledge of what's going on in Venezuela about 3 years ago. I watched a documentary, which I'm sure your watchers now will be familiar with, The Revolution Will Not Be Televised. I watched that, and I have to admit, I cried at the end of it. There was tears streaming down my face. I was extremely impressed. I was so impressed, in fact, I actually got on the telephone to the Venezuelan, tried to contact the Venezuelan embassy, simply to ask, what can I do for Venezuela? You know, what can I do as an Englishman in the UK to help Hugo Chavez, to help what's going on in Venezuela? Fortunately, it's very difficult to get hold of anybody in the Venezuelan embassy. You just get put through to a lot of options on who to call, you know, for visas and all these things. It's very difficult to get hold of a human being. However, I carried on looking into, I kept up with Hugo Chavez. When I still had the Twitter account, I followed the Twitters. I followed as many news articles as I could, watching what was happening in Venezuela. Really, the important thing about what's going on in Venezuela is it's one of the few examples in the world today of successful social revolution in the hands of the people, and devolution of power from centralized government into the hands of local people. Some of the things that impressed me, for instance, were the was when Hugo Chavez came into power, the story of how many of the business owners shut down the factories, believing that if they shut down the factories, the economy would come to a grinding halt within a couple of months, and they would have no option but to pass power back to the corporate heads. Hugo Chavez would have no option but to give up power. However, the people simply went back to work and said, well, we're not having that, we're going to go to work. And fundamentally, I think what those elites, for the sake of this conversation, I'll call them elites, what they failed to factor into account was the fact that it's the people that run the factories. They knew the factories inside and out. They are the ones that tighten the widgets. They're the ones that wrap the packages, that make the deliveries. They know that factory inside and out. The elites haven't got a clue. They just crunch numbers. They just, you know, buy stocks and shares and sit back and eat, drink martinis and enjoy the profits. And so the people knew that they could go into those factories, they could not only keep those factories running, but that they could make them run better, more efficiently. And when they took over the factories and essentially, I'm not sure what the term is for it, but shared profits, where they all had a share in the business, took over those factories and had an equal share in what was produced in that factory, factories became more efficient, they became more productive, the workers were much more happier, and it just generally overall created a much better feel and ambience for everybody involved, and completely backfired in the elite's face. That's one example of what was important, that I felt was extremely important. Another example was the what they seem to be doing in the larger cities. Now, I think it's Brazil that calls it favelas. I'm not sure what the Venezuelan equivalent to that is, but you have densely packed urban areas with city streets, you know, buildings piled on top of each other. Very, very difficult to control, especially from a centralized point of view. Very difficult to maintain. So they've introduced a system whereby it's split up into set communities of 200-300 families, and those 200-300 families have their own committee. They know what they need in their area. They know if the streets need fixing, they know if the lighting needs fixing, they know if there's problems with the water. They know what needs doing, and all they need is the funds to be able to do it. And so they can, they've been given the autonomy and the funds to be able to do that, and that, as far as I'm aware, has shown great success. These are things that can be implemented here in the UK. Now, we think, because unfortunately this is the thing, the UK considers, people in the UK consider themselves to be a developed country. You know, we don't, the word or the term third world doesn't, we don't really apply that here. But really, although we have widescreen televisions and we have, you know, coffee machines and we have constant running water, which on the surface, in a materialistic way, shows that we're not a third world country. But from a social standpoint, from a communal standpoint, we are very, very backwards. We are very, very third world. We're poor. We experience social poverty here to an extreme degree. And what's happening in Venezuela is a beacon, if you will. It shows what can be done when people stand up together and say, right, well, we're not going to take this anymore. We're not going to bend to the will of a few at the top and be led by those few. We know what needs doing. We know how hard our lives are. We know what we need to do to fix our lives. We just need to be given the space, the time, and the power to be able to do it. And essentially seize that power for themselves, which they have done. Of course, it's helped that they've had somebody like Hugo Chavez at the top, who's been able to, from that end of the spectrum, leverage that power back to the people, piece by piece. Obviously, it's very difficult. It's probably been extremely difficult for Hugo Chavez to do that, but he's been doing it slowly over time, further and further, more and more power here, a bit there, and slowly devolving that power back to the people. And as a result, I think it's nothing short of a social miracle that's going on in Venezuela and in other South American countries as well, spurred on, I believe, by Venezuela. So I think it's extremely important what's going on in Venezuela for us today in the UK.
Okay. In terms of, you know, we've seen an election in Venezuela this weekend. You know, it was part of a long-running process. Chavez has been elected probably more than any president that people could generally mention, and in a way that the capitalist world has had to acknowledge is fair. You know, they can't fault the electoral process in Venezuela. And I think the documentary you referred to just shows, you know, what real democracy is. Mm. You know, it's the people actually saying, hey, no, we're not going to stand for this. You know, this is our leader. We're going to fight for the gains that we've managed to achieve. Mm. How do you think that compares with, you know, the kind of so-called democracy that we come to expect in our country? You know, what can you say about the process in Venezuela in comparison to that?
Well, we don't have a democratic process here in the UK. It seems to be a democratic process, but it very much isn't. It's maybe plutocracy is more accurate, or techocracy is more accurate. We have technocrats more than democratically elected politicians. I mean, one thing I'm always fond of saying to people is that here in Britain, we every 4 years we elect a new dictator, which is essentially what we do, because that's where our democracy stops, really. It starts and stops at that election every 4 years. Once we've elected the officials, then it doesn't matter what the people think. If we lived in a true democracy, we would have never gone into war with Iraq, because people weren't in favour of going into war with Iraq. I think at the time it was something like 76% of the people of this country were not in favour of going to war in Iraq. So the government created a nice little false flag down in London and spurred people's opinion more towards the Iraq war. But that was after the fact. We went into war anyway. They just needed people's opinion to be a bit further forward. It's quite clever, really, because
one of the things we have, I know in America, for instance, no president could stay in power for more than two terms. Here in Britain, and it's very rare for any prime minister to stay in power for more than 8 years. I think Tony Blair was the first for a prime minister to stay, and he stayed on for, what was it, 12 years, I think it was. Nightmare that was. One of the key points when it comes to the democratic process, the difference in democracy between here and Venezuela is the political will of the people themselves. Here in the UK, of all the European countries, probably of most countries in the world, we have a keen lethargia when it comes to politics. I remember years ago, when I was younger and I actually believed politics could play a part and politics could work, to a decent degree. I think I was 14 at the time. There was a Cocoa Pops, a popular cereal here in the UK, changed its name to Choco Krispies. You might be wondering where this is going. But there was an outrage across the country that this name had changed on a cereal box. And so they opened up the phone lines and said, you can vote whether you want to keep the name as Cocoa Pops or Choco Krispies. In the ensuing 2 months, I believe it was something somewhere along the lines of 21 to 24% more people in this country voted on the name of a cereal than in the general elections themselves. 24% more people in this country voted for a name of a cereal than on who was going to be running the country, who was going to be setting policies on who are going to be engaging on the very topics and issues that are infused in our day-to-day lives. People had more concern over this, and it shocked me. You know, it shocked me to the bone. I think that was the beginning of my disillusionment with politics in this country. Now, I've sort of come to a happy medium now. There was a time when I completely been done with politics. I said the best way to vote is to not vote. I often said the biggest impact we could make in this country is if absolutely nobody went to the polling stations. That would send a shocking message. That would send more of a message than any other kind of voting technique or practice. It would essentially send a message that this system doesn't work. It needs to change. I still believe that's true. I still believe that would send a much more of a shocking message. I don't have so much of a bone against politics anymore. I still believe there could be a political way to solve things and to change issues, but I don't think it's going to be on the general election scale. I don't think it will come from centralized government, voting for a centralized government. I believe it will come from what Venezuela have already started to do, the devolution of power to segmented parts within society. Over the last, several decades, there's been, since the end of World War II, since the forming of the European Union especially, there's been moves to constantly centralise power, which makes it much easier for the few at the top to control. But each step to a greater centralisation takes more and more power out of the hands of the likes of you and me on the street. Every step towards centralisation at the top decentralises our power at the bottom. And the simple fact of the matter is, it is us at the bottom, I say in inverted commas, that understand the most what is going on in society, how things are impacting us on a day-to-day basis. So who are more better qualified to suggest ideas or to implement changes that are going to improve our lives than the ones who are living the implications of the decisions made every single day.
Okay. In terms of, you know, whether Venezuela and Bolivia, Cuba, you know, we see them as bringing in a new form of politics, a politics that is more you know, relevant to working class people. Do you think there is a relevance to the struggle against austerity in Britain, you know, in this period of unprecedented cuts in public services and attacks on working class living conditions? Do you think then what's going on in Latin America has a relevance to that?
Very much so. On the basic level of the seizing of power from the people, I mean, that in and of itself is an example that's being set by the people in South America. Now, I know from my experiences of living in Spain, you know, Latin people tend to be very fiery people. They always tend to be have a leaning towards political awareness. They tend to be very active in this area generally as a people. But what's happening in South America is even steps further. The austerity that's going on today in Europe, especially in the UK, people don't even realise. I think it was mentioned at FRFI meeting that here in Britain we are still 3 years behind the impact of the austerity measures that are being brought into place than any other country in Europe. And when that hits, you know, it's going to hurt people and they're not going to know what's happening. As I said, there's a big, great lethargy in this country at the moment. People are sort of milling around, going from day to day, not really understanding. It's as if they know there's something wrong, but they can't quite grasp what it is that's going on. They just know that there's something not quite right. And some of them maybe do intuitively, subconsciously understand what is going on. But it's almost a fear to admit it, because in admitting it, it then leads to personal responsibility. Because once you admit that there's something wrong, and that you, even if you only have the slightest understanding of what's wrong, it then behooves you to do something about it. It then behooves you to take personal responsibility and to do something, anything you can, to contribute to a change, to bring about a betterment for yourself, for your family, and for the wider family that is your society in which you live in. Now, the people of South America have done that. This is what they've done. They've seized that personal responsibility, and they have and they've seized it with great courage. They've shown no fear. They've said, this is the way things are. It's wrong. This is the way we want things to be. And we are prepared to do what it takes in order to achieve that. We are prepared to take personal responsibility. There's none of this lethargy over there. There is almost a fiery will and spirit to do it. And that is, for me, something that needs to be exported to this country. That will, that fire, you know, that passion, the desire to do something, and to not only suck it up and take the personal responsibility and say, all right, well, I'm going to have to do something, but to relish it. And you know, there is no greater time than the time in which you're living. And this time that we are living in currently, this period in human history, is massive. It's huge. I mean, we are literally at a make or break point in history. Over the next subsequent years, things could go either extremely well. We could seize back power, and we could create a new world that is beautiful, wonderful, productive, healthy, a great world to give to our children. Or we could very much easily go the other way, a destructive, polluted, unhealthy earth that we will leave to our grandchildren, and they will ask why. Why did we do that? And but this moment, we are at a pivotal moment in human history, and what's happening now in South America, what the people in South America are now doing is truly revolutionary, but not just a physical form of revolution, not just a mental form of revolution, it's a spiritual revolution as well. They've understood fundamentally that it's not just a physical thing, it's not just the bread on the table, but it's the mind in the head, and it's the soul in the heart. This is what they're fighting for. It's a trinity, a sort of a trinity revolution. They understand this very much, and this is what they're surging forward with, and that is very much what needs to be exported here.
Down on the streets, so where my drum beats, in between the clean sheets of my love life. Ah, we all know how that feels, don't we, lads? I wasn't referring to now, thank you very much, but since you bring it up. Anyway, yeah, that was Roy Harper, favourite artist of mine that I always play on the show. I hope you can forgive me for that. That was Highway Blues. So, yeah, that was part one of my interview. I hope you enjoyed it. I do drone on. I do have a tendency to drone on. In fact, actually, after the interview, they said, they were like, well, but actually, there's a lot more than we expected there. I think they underestimated my capacity for gabbing on, really. So, yeah, I'm just going to quickly refresh the studio page here because just to make sure the second part of the Venezuelan interview has loaded up correctly. Also, I'm going to play for you in a second a recording I made when I went to attend my second bail hearing. This is a copy of a recording I'll be sending to my solicitors. I'll also be sending to the chief constable at the police station, informing them that it has and will be on public record in regards to me not consenting to another bail. Now, when I did the recording, actually, from beginning to end, pressing record to stopping it, it was 10 minutes worth of recording. Of that 10 minutes, actual interaction between me and anybody at the police station consisted of a mere 2 minutes 23 seconds. So that's how quick this was. It really wasn't worth the train ticket to Swinton and back again. But it's funny. It's funny. So yeah, I thought that this is a piece of evidence I will be using in my favour. An actual verbal recording, a confession of a policeman saying that you don't have to consent. So I've got that on recording, you know what I mean? Also, I'll have on this recording his lack of informing me that I'll be arrested if I didn't attend the future bail. He didn't say it. So pretty much out of the loop, really, to be honest with you. Yeah. So, in fact, I'll play that now, since we're on the topic. Here we go. Well, I'm the executive director for that state.
Who are you then? Who are you?
I'm commonly called Kel.
Are you Miquel Llobera?
I'm the executive director for that state, yes.
So you are Miquel Llobera?
I'm not that company or that estate. I'm a representative for that estate.
Who's Miquel Llobera?
I'm commonly called Miquel Llobera.
Right. Also known as Miquel Llobera.
I'm also known as Miquel Llobera. That's in block capital letters, you see, so that denotes a company or estate.
I just want to know if you're Miquel Llobera.
I'm the valid one to attend this matter, yeah.
Are you here?
Again.
That's all I want to know. Is that you?
I'm commonly called by that same name, so
right.
If that makes you happy, that's fine.
I'll see you. I'll get somebody else here.
Thank you very much.
Be careful. Right, I'm terrible to ask. We're going to be rebailed. Come back again. The reason being, we've not got friendly results back yet. Okay.
I can't consent to another bail.
Well, you don't. Well,
consent.
I don't consent.
You don't have to consent.
I'm afraid I can't sign anything.
Which is, right. Okay.
That's fine. I can't consent to another bail. I've got a 2-week-old baby, and it's been 4 months already.
Right. Okay. I'll give you that anyway.
Okay. Thank you.
In fact, put it on there. That's up there. 13th of November, 1100 hours.
I can't.
If you fail to
work.
If you fail.
I can't accept any paperwork.
Well.
I can't accept any paperwork, sorry, sir.
Right, okay, fine, off you go.
Right, I can't accept any paperwork.
Right, okay, fine, off you go. Don't turn on.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
reason I was saying I can't. Oh, sorry, that's my baby boy kicking up a fuss there. He doesn't like police either. But the reason you keep hearing me say I can't accept any paperwork is because he kept trying to give me the piece of paper. He kept trying to give me the piece of paper. That's why I was saying he began the sentence. If you don't accept. He was going to say if you don't attend you will be arrested, but he couldn't finish the sentence. He said if you don't attend, I've not accepted any paperwork. If you don't attend, I've not accepted any paperwork. Folded it up, tried to give me it, not accepted any paperwork. Crossed my arms. I had to cross my arms because he was shoving it at me. I said no. He said right, go on, get out then. And the very last one, he opened up the door for me to go into the reception, and then he tried to pass me again as I'm walking out. And that's the last one when I say I can't accept any paperwork. And he went wonderful. Shut the door behind me. So, and I posed the question, quite obvious, you know, the immediate obvious question to me is, if it didn't matter whether or not I accepted the paperwork, that they could arrest me anyway, if I didn't attend, why was he so insistent on trying to give me the paperwork? Several times he tried to give me the paperwork. If it really didn't matter, if it was no skin off his nose, whether I took it or not, whether I signed on it, whether I took the piece of paperwork or not, they would arrest me anyway if I didn't attend. If it didn't matter at all, why was he so insistent on trying to give me the paperwork? Well, I would propose that it's because it's essential that I take the paperwork, because regardless of whether I'd signed it or not, me taking that paperwork is essentially being served, is accepting that contract. In my hand, and I refused to do that, which is why he was so fervently trying to give it to me. So he would have had to walk into that police station with two pieces of paper, one which he should have given to me, neither with my signature on it, and just him writing refused to sign on it. Now, as far as I'm aware, that part of the police station didn't have any recording equipment in it, so it's his word against mine to begin with, and he has both pieces of paper, so I have not been served. I've not been served notice. I've not been in receipt of any paperwork. So I'm going to be shortly constructing a notice to send to the police station, basically informing them that I refused to contract. That the policeman himself admitted that I didn't have to consent, which he did. He also failed to inform me that I would be arrested should I not turn up on that date, which he didn't. He didn't inform me that. Also, I'm going to be including the court ruling that stated that the Queen is illegitimate. So any act of Parliament from 1952 onwards is invalid. Also, I'm going to be including the paperwork that states quite clearly that unless I have been taken to court within 6 months of the initial arrest, that the matter has to be dropped. Because I'm entitled to an unbiased and speedy trial, and I believe the date that I was supposed to attend for the third bail was the 13th, 13th of November. And funnily enough, I came back today to the flat to do the show, and I had a letter from my lawyer, not solicitor, saying, further to your attending the above police station, we have received confirmation that you have been released and bailed to re-attend the police station on the 13th of November 2012 at 11 a.m. Right now, so that first sentence is completely erroneous because, you know, I was released and bailed. No, I wasn't released because I wasn't being held. I voluntarily attended the police station, so I wasn't being held. So how can they release me when they weren't holding me? And second of all, and had been bailed to re-attend. Well, I hadn't been bailed to re-attend because I didn't sign for it, I didn't accept the paperwork, so I haven't been bailed at all. And it just goes on to say it's normally necessary for them to attend with me if the police are going to conduct another interview or the new evidence come up or whatever. So I'm going to send the solicitor a copy of the notice I'm sending to the police along with a CD with the recording burnt onto it. I'm considering putting some other stuff on the CD as well, maybe some documentaries or recordings. I don't know. I'm thinking about it. But we'll see about that. For the moment, I just need to make sure I get that notice in, get those pieces of legislation about the Queen and about 6 months needing to have a trial within 6 months. Otherwise, it just blows out. My friend and yours, Rob Freeman, is going to be helping me out with that once he's finished sorting out what he's got on his plate at the moment, and he has got a lot on his plate at the moment. Bless him. One of our champions. So yeah, it's a bit of a laughable fiasco anyway, really. So whatever happens, I'm not attending the police station on that day. They can shut off. As far as I'm done, I'm washing my hands of it. And I'm not going to be in this flat anyway, so if they send police around to come and arrest me, I'm not even going to be here, and they're not going to know where I am anyway, so... So, that's that matter done and dusted with, so... So any advice, guys, if you want to, if you feel like you want to let me know anything extra or got any little tidbits you think I should know, then send it on over to peaceofmind@criticalmassradio.co.uk. Always happy for a little bit of help, any template letters or any suggestions that I should put in my notice, suggestions as to how I can should construct my notice, anything really. I'm more than open to suggestion. Not in the kind of hypnotic watching TV way open to suggestion, but I'm open to the suggestions that you suggest in order to help assist me.
Do you think there's a significance to the fact that there's a growing anti-imperialist unity amongst Latin American countries, you know, led by Venezuela, you know, which is expressed in the emergence of organisations like ALBA, which are kind of a regional bloc, you know, to challenge the dominance of imperialism in the region? You know, do you think that unity is, you know, has a significant impact?
Well, it does. I mean, it just demonstrates the common people's understanding of, because I know literacy is pretty low in a lot of South American countries, but they don't need to read or write to be able to understand what's going on. Fundamentally what's going on, and the ALBA and this bloc that's been formed to stand against imperialism, it's just simply a physical manifestation. It was always destined to occur, a physical manifestation. It's almost, because I mean, I think there was always the anti-imperialism there anyway. Everybody always understood fundamentally that there was this influence from these other countries in some faraway lands who were capping oil prices, or who were placing unpayable debts, burdens onto the country, who were destroying the infrastructure for the profits of people in a land far away that they will never even meet. You know, and I think what's happened is it's very difficult, I think, for politicians in South America. Because I think probably in South America, more than any other geological location in the earth, there are probably more honest politicians per capita in South America than any other continent on the planet. But it's very difficult for South American politicians because, unfortunately, politics as it stands today plays by a very skewed set of rules. That you've got to tick so many boxes, you've got to file so many papers, and in order to make things legitimate in the eyes of other countries on other continents, and so they've had to play this very delicate balance of being able to shift the power to the people, but also being able to almost as if it were put up a bureaucratic shield and shield and sword against those other countries around the world, because they need to be able to make everything they do legitimate in the eyes of the rest of the world, but at the same time fulfill the promises and what they understand to be crucial and necessary for the people. So it's a very delicate balance. I feel very sorry for South American politicians, really, because of this dance and this act that they've got to go through. But at the same time, they're not afraid to just basically say, well, sod you, go away. You know what I mean? We're going to do it this way, and we don't care whether you like it or not. I think what ALBA is I think that's how it started off very much. It was very much a fingers up to the rest of the world and say, no, we're going to do this way. We're going to give power back to the people. We're going to do things for the people, not for the few at the top. But I think as time's moved on, they've understood the necessity to create something, a buffer, if you will, a firewall, for the inevitable questions and bureaucracy that was going to be thrown their way from other countries around the world, which I suppose you could say is a necessary evil, but the anti-imperialism sentiment, I think, has always been there. I think it's always been there in the core of the people. They've always understood that this is what's going on. And what's happened now within the likes of Hugo Chavez in Venezuela, within the likes of Castro in Cuba, they have within the embodiment of that sentiment in leaders who are willing to try and bring about the change, to stop imperialism and to bring about a socialist movement that's going to benefit future generations.
Okay, that was my last question. Have you got any others?
I don't know.
You've covered quite a lot.
Yeah, you've covered quite a lot.
I thought I'd have to keep making up more questions, but...
Do I have any more? I don't know, maybe we can say, for example, what the recent election, yesterday election in Venezuela, mm-hmm. What does it mean for Venezuela, for the future generation, and for the greater Latin American movement, mm-hmm. and for other countries in the region, in terms of, you know, fighting with imperialism?
Well, I think it's... in and of itself, it's not any great step forward. It's just another good step forward. I think what's been happening in South America now has been started off as some really great steps forward, which is good. But now what has happened is it's spread. It's now slowed down to what I suppose you could say a manageable pace. It's come to a pace of and to be honest with you, I think I would prefer to see many small good steps, secure positive steps, rather than juttery, shaky, you know, great step there, and because that quite often great steps forward can often lead to great falls back, but a constant progression forward is very much what needed to happen, in my opinion. Again, with the formation of ALBA and them sort of creating a bloc whereby they can dance to the tune of the rest of the world, but with the policies and the with the social understanding of what they needed to do for the people within the within South America. I mean, within my show, A Peace of Mind, I deal with obviously personal psychology, personal spirituality. I think. And a very important aspect of what's going on in Venezuela is the spiritual aspect of things. There's a massive spiritual awakening occurring in this world generally at the moment, but it's the centrality of it has shifted to South America. There's something called Kundalini energy. And it previously, for the last so many thousands, 13,000 years, was in Tibet, and now it has shifted to South America, to Peru and the surrounding areas. That's why we've had so many spiritual leaders come from Tibet and from India, so many gurus. And now that that's shifted over to South America, I think what we will see, not just within the political realm, but within other realms within South America, we'll see a great emergence of not just political willpower, but spiritual willpower. And I'm not talking religious dogma. I think South America, of all the continents on the planet, have had it up to here with religious dogma. I think the Catholics sent to South America and they devastated everything. You know, so they understand the danger of religion. But spirituality that's occurring over there now is massive, it's huge. And this is key. This is a really, really key point, because without that spiritual and emotional balance, what you will end up finding occurring, and there's always the danger with a revolution, is this fall into violence. You can look back throughout history, and you know, you have the French Revolution led to Napoleon, you had the Bolshevik Revolution led to the likes of Stalin, you had the revolutions in Germany, which would eventually lead to Hitler. All these revolutions, which were great when they occurred, because there was something that needed to happen, there needed to be social change, but unfortunately, without emotional balance and without spiritual balance, what occurred was it became a thing of vengeance, and a thing of bitterness, and a thing of all these hateful emotions. And as a result of that, they became the revolutions, although they were great things, they were tinged with fear. And when people are afraid is when they are most easily controlled. And people are most easily afraid when they have a small sense of their own emotional balance or spiritual balance. And as a result, they become easily led. And what's happening in South America now, I think, I mean, I've talked to people from South America. I have several friends from South America, from Brazil, from Uruguay, from Peru. Unfortunately, I don't have any friends from Venezuela yet. But whenever I talk to these people and talk to people from South America, I very much get a sense that it's, although they are angry, it is a constructive kind of anger. And there's no longer any fear. And there's no resentment or bitterness. It is... it's just a strong resolve and that comes from an understanding of what needs to be done, how it needs to be done. And there is no desire for revenge. There is no desire for, there's no grudges being held. Whereas over here in the UK, within the movements I'm involved in, things like Lawful Rebellion, what we call the Truth Movement, whatever that is, but the Truth Movement, there's very much anger, but a bitter anger and a sense for revenge and this desire to hang the people at the top, to make them pay for the things that they've done. And unfortunately, that echoes throughout history through previous revolutions as ultimately unsound, because ultimately that will lead to something worse down the line. Whereas in South America, what they've done is they've almost on a fundamental level, they've understood this principle, and they said, no, we're not going to seek revenge. We're not going to put the heads of those who've oppressed us on blocks and chop them off. We're just going to move them out of the way and say, go away. We're taking back the power for us. We've got no desire to hurt you. We've got no desire to punish you. We just want to live our lives how we know we should be living them, how we know is going to be beneficial for us, for our children, for our grandchildren and future generations down the line. And that doesn't involve taking off heads, it doesn't involve hanging people or shooting people, it just involves us taking back the power that should have always been ours to begin with.
Right, and that was part two, final part of my interview with the guys making the Venezuelan documentary here. Two chaps that came and said at the beginning of the show, Nathan and Lewis, very nice chaps. Had a good chat with them before and afterwards as well. Cut all that out though. That's the key core of the. It was probably bits of that will be used in the documentary up and coming. If you want to check out what's going on in Venezuela, go to www.vivavenezuela.co.uk. Takes you through to a blog, everything that's going on there, all the social progression that's going on there, not just in Venezuela, but in Cuba and in the other countries in the Alba Bloc. Very interesting stuff, very progressive stuff. We can learn a lot from what's going on in South America. They are torchbearers. They are really shining the way forward over there, really, really are. Some very positive stuff going on over there. Really, really, really happy and proud to be part of a documentary about it, really, to be honest. All those years ago when I first heard about what was happening in Venezuela, and I watched The Revolution Will Not Be Televised, which if you haven't seen, I would recommend very much. Excellent, excellent video, that is, documentary about real life events that really went on. Hair-raising stuff, and you'll be in tears. If you value freedom and liberty and power in the hands of the people, that documentary will make you cry. It's amazing. And to think that 3 years on, I would be being interviewed in conjunction with a documentary being made about social movements going on in the UK, parallel to what's happening in Venezuela, and making comparisons between the two. I couldn't be happier. I'm very pleased about that. So I just hope I've contributed in a positive way, and that people can take from it something positive from it, and move forward. So I've got my son cradled in my arms at the moment. He was kicking up a bit of a fuss earlier. I think the hearing the police on the recording sent him off. He doesn't like uniforms, do you, mate? You don't like uniforms, do you? No. So,
we're going to be training this one well. We're going to be training this one well.
He's
not going to hate the police. No, oh no, no, no. I'm going to teach him to see the human being under the uniform. And I'm going to teach him to distrust the uniform. Trust the human being, not the uniform. So, yeah. Right, well, my time is ticking down. So if I am running till 5 minutes to, as I have been the last couple of episodes, I've only got roughly 10 minutes left. Plus, I need to get everything packed up ready, PC everything packed up ready to go back up north. So that's going to take me a little while.
You're listening to Critical Mass Radio. This is A Peace of Mind. Me, your host, Miquel Llobera.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Thank you very much for your attention, for your ears. And I hope to be hearing from you soon. Tune in for the Critical Mass show coming up with the patron saint of Critical Mass Radio, Paul Giovanni. It's been an absolute pleasure. Although I have yet to attain omnipresent super intergalactic oneness, I'm almost there, and so are you. Good night.